Yeah, I think when shortly after I joined the community and I heard you saying this is a lifelong journey, in a way that takes the goal off the timeline for me. And I know probably for others as well, just because there was such a goal-driven mindset to want to know that I will get it, and I think I'm getting it soon, when like it's like a dangling carrot, just cannot reach it, and there is a frustration. But once I heard and truly embraced it, okay, this is a lifetime, this is a practice that's gonna last till the end of time, basically, then there is suddenly no pressure for a goal on a linear time to say, where am I at? Comparing myself with others, comparing myself with anything in a timeline. But it's just, you know, the more the fruit, the more it indicates the work behind it. The work is the mind work, the sincerity to just not let any situation be pushed away. You know, the mind, when it's so-called lazy to not doing the mind training work, what it does is just to push a situation away and saying, okay, you know, I don't need to look at it, or I know how to go about it. There's no prayer behind it. So there is a lot of work, you know, on our daily life. On the surface, we're very joyful, but behind it, there is so much prayer all day long, never-ending prayer, to just want to see the guidance, you know, want to see we are following this guidance, and also know our mind is fixated, is anchored in asking the spirit. That is the direction we're giving to the mind. And I watch David, he probably wakes up, just ask, what do you have me do, spirit? And then he doesn't stop all day long. Even though the body is busy, the mind is still. But it's like one prompt after the next. And that becomes the practice behind the joy.
Yeah, I think what has happened with seemingly modern society is it could be called the quick fix society. Mm. So we transfer this quick fix mentality to everything, including our spiritual path. So then, instead of thinking like back in the days when people would devote their whole life maybe to a monastery or a spiritual calling, that was part of their promises and their vows. Okay, I give my whole life over to you, Jesus, and that's it. Now lead the way. Now it's turned more into a vending machine mentality. Imagine going to a vending machine with a few dollars to put the coins in the vending machine, and you say, okay, I'm at the spiritual enlightenment vending machine, and I've got my money. I've saved up my money, I've got my money, so please insert your money. You insert, you're in the enlightenment vending machine, you insert the dollars or euros or coins, whatever you've got. And then it goes, and then you take your enlightenment out of the bottom of the vending machine. You go, thank you, Jesus. That was it. That's what I wanted. That I know. Basically, it was actually Esther that wrote in the "I need do nothing" thing, which sometimes people even use the "I need do nothing." I said, did you take the course? They said, oh yeah, I took the course. I took a course in miracles about 12 years ago. How did it go for you? Oh, it was good. I was on to my next books. Oh, you think the course is a book? Oh, the course is not a book. The book actually has the line inside the book. You will believe this course will be believed entirely or not at all. What? I thought it said I need to do nothing. No. He threw that in there. He threw some candy in there. But actually it says this course will be believed entirely or not at all. So it's a matter of mind, of really getting faith in the Holy Spirit so that you don't need the book anymore. You have such a prayer for the Holy Spirit's guidance and Jesus' guidance that you reach a point where you don't need the book. And yet, oftentimes on the spiritual journey, people have a feeling like it's just reading words in a book, in a scripture. You know, sometimes people believe the Bible is the word of God, it's the only way, and so on and so forth, even though the Course says it's just one form of the universal curriculum and that there are many pathways to God. Even the Course says, you know, forget this world, forget this Course. It's not designed to generate a dependency on the book, but it is designed to generate a dependency on the Holy Spirit. You know, we have to say that's a good form of dependency. If the Holy Spirit is your remembrance of who you really are, and the Holy Spirit is the one who gives you the guidance and instructions on how to wake up and transcend the body, to go beyond the body, then you want to be addicted to the Holy Spirit. And you don't even have to call it the Holy Spirit. You can call it intuition. You can call it higher self. You can call it Atman. You can call it Fred. You can call it Jane. You could call it anything you want. You could even call it poop if you want. People always like it when I say that word. But imagine that was your inner, your higher self. What's the name? Poop. I'm going to tune into poop right now. You can give it any name you want. See, the Holy Spirit doesn't care what you call the Holy Spirit. Male, female, androgynous. Oh, androgynous higher self, I call upon you. You know, he, she, it. He, she, him, her. You know, it's so funny to watch humans. Him, her. God the Father, God the Mother. Father, Mother, Father, Mother, Father, Mother. I go to some churches, they can't say the word God. Father, Mother. Father, Mother, they want to be so inclusive of both sexes. Father, Mother, Father, Mother, Father, Mother. You know, I just laugh at all the human ways because it's all just trying to connect with the presence that knows the way, how to wake up. And that's really what this whole Beyond the Body retreat is about connecting with that inner presence and trusting that inner presence. And when fear comes up, just again, taking a pause, taking a deep breath, and just saying, okay, I trust. And I know that you're going to send me whatever I need, mighty companions, signs, symbols. If I can't hear your voice, you're going to make it obvious to me. You're going to bring it through somebody else's voice, or you're going to bring it through a bumper sticker or a billboard, or you'll bring it in a flower or something. You're going to find a way to reach me because you love me so much, and you can reach past this fear that I have in my mind. So that's the great thing. But as Francis is saying, it takes a full devotion. You can't be on the spiritual journey and try to divorce it as just one category of your day or just one category of your worldly life. You want to be able to see God in every moment. You want to be among the ordinary, seemingly ordinary occurrences that are part of your day-to-day living. Wasn't that the way of the peaceful warrior? That was one of the realizations. There are no ordinary moments. Every moment is extraordinary. Every single moment is spectacular. Imagine using that word when you think of this moment. How you doing? Spectacular. What's happening in your life that is so spectacular? It's what's happening in my heart that's so spectacular. It's what's happening in my mind that's so spectacular. It's not saying that the things that I'm perceiving are, but if I'm in a spectacular state of mind, then everything that I perceive would be spectacular. And if I'm having a spectacular heart feeling, then it would be everything I experience from my heart is spectacular. That's who we are and how we perceive the world is the central place in the dreaming of this world. That's what it means to be the dreamer. You're a spectacular dreamer. You're not just an ordinary dreamer. You're a spectacular dreamer, and you dream a spectacular dream because of who you are, not at the mercy of the world. You are empowered in mind.